Thank you for breaking out the new music this morning, Richard and Isa and Avery and Jean. And welcome everyone to worship today on this beautiful Sunday morning on the 23rd of January. I still can't believe it every time I say it. 23rd of January, 2022. Welcome all of you here and who are joining us online. This is an exciting day for many reasons. Someone asked me why I'm wearing maroon today. It's just a coincidence. But it did make me think of something I saw. We finally found out that something that Aaron Rodgers is immunized against, it's beating the 49ers in the playoffs. Now, I say that, and I was very hesitant to say that initially, because I don't want to alienate any of our Green Bay fans, but I'm sorry, I did. And I'm still a Patriots fan, so I don't have a dog in this fight. But anyway, having said all of that, welcome all of you to worship. This is a place where whether you wear green and gold or maroon and gold, you are welcome in the light and love of Christ. I want to ask if there are any visitors that are here with us this morning that would like to make themselves known. What are your names and how did you end up coming this morning?
I'm Vicki Brooks from Danville, California, and I've Pam's best friend since the ninth
grade. Oh, that's so great. I love it. So Vicki and...
I'm John. John Marshall. I'm from Georgia.
Oh, wonderful. Vicki and John, welcome. And yes, thank you for being here as friends of Pam and John as well.
They come as much as we do.
Well, maybe you should just move out here. Welcome to worship this morning. Anyone else? Well, I want to welcome all of you who are here this morning, whether it's your first time or your 500th time, as we like to say, and it's very important to say, in the United Church of Christ and here at First Congregational Church of Auburn. Wherever you are on the journey of faith, the journey of life, wherever you have been, wherever you will be, you are welcome here. This is your church, so welcome home, everyone. In that spirit, I want to invite you to, as safely and carefully as possible, perhaps using prayer hands, to rise and to turn around and find ways to greet one another in the name and the love of Christ. Return to our seats as we are able. It's a welcome problem having you all get up and enjoy seeing each other and saying hello so much. So that's a beautiful thing. Friends, I want to invite you into a space of prayer and attentiveness as I move into some of the prayer concerns that we have for today, but also some of the announcements, some of the upcoming events here at church. So please be with me in that spirit. First of all, our annual meeting will be held immediately after church, so I want to invite all church members to please do attend as we vote on this year's budget. We'll hear a foundation report, and we'll vote in our officers and church board members. It will take place immediately after the worship service, and it should be a brief meeting, so please do stay if you are a church member. Also, after that, after the annual meeting, Joyce Isham will be selling crab feed tickets, which is now on April 2nd. The crab feed itself, but she's selling tickets and they'll be at the back of the church, or she said outside, but I think, Joyce, just stay inside if it's too cold outside to sell the tickets. But that's after the annual meeting. Next Sunday, we're going to have a very, not a very, I'm always, that's one of my pet peeves when people say very unique. But we're going to have a unique worship opportunity. And I'm calling it Theater Church. If you saw your weekend update, you have an inkling of what this is. But next week, our entire worship will center around a live-acted play that's written and directed by one of my good friends from The Drowsy Chaperone, Jay Evans. He played Felzig, the producer. And you would recognize him from the old-time radio shows that we've been having up here, gosh, for 2 years now, regularly. And it's called The Do-Gooder Debacle, and it is a modern retelling of the well-known, beloved parable of the Good Samaritan. And it's a full-length play that they will tailor to be about 1 hour and 15 minutes. You'll recognize some of the actors as well from Drowsy Chaperone. And they've been performing it. They started this past Wednesday. They've gotten rave reviews. It's funny. It's heartfelt. So I'm really excited. And I hope that more you and many more will be able to attend. I don't believe we're going to be able to record this. So for anyone that's watching, please do, if you're able to, attend live in person. So it'll be normal church start time, and it'll go a little late after 11 o'clock next week. So I hope you can all make it for the Do-Gooder Debacle. I love that. I got to incorporate that into one of my sermons. Okay, so this morning we want to pray for one of our UCC mission co-workers. His name is Fritz Gerald Joseph, and he serves at the Evangelical Church of Morocco, which is itself often called the Crossroad Church, partly because of where Morocco sits in the crossroads of Europe, Africa, and the Middle East. So we pray for the welcoming and diverse ministry of Fritz and all who serve there. And we ask God to bless their ministries. I want to pray for the McGuire family. One of our prayer cards this morning lifts up the McGuire family and their daughter, Kelly, in particular, who is 38 years old, and she has advanced cancer. And in the challenging situation on top of that, her husband is in a hotel with COVID, and her father is positive also. So we pray for them all in this very difficult time. May the peace, may the strength, may the love of God and the community of love from our prayers be felt by this family, and may it provide them strength. And then the last one I have is a note of personal prayer. I want to say happy birthday to my eldest son, Wyatt, who turns 10 tomorrow. Wow. 10! I know, 10 tomorrow. And it's a big number. And I mean, from now on, he's in double digits. That's how it goes. And it's been such a gift for my wife and I. There they are right now. Perfect timing, guys. It's been a gift for my wife and I to be his parents, that we get to be his parents. And of course, as you may know, his birthday virtually coincides with my arrival here. He was only 6 weeks old when we moved out here to Auburn. And so it always reminds me of that, and that is also a gift that I get to remain your minister in these days and years. So thank you all, and happy birthday, Wyatt. I want to invite you into a space of quiet prayer right now. And if you have a name or a joy or concern that you'd like to lift up at this time, say it aloud. You're welcome to do that. And then after that time of silence, I'll lead us in a pastoral prayer, and we'll say the Lord's Prayer together. God, in these days that remind us in so many ways of how fragile life can be, when the news reminds us of pandemic and the potential for disaster, when the stresses of life as it finds us each day can make us feel crazy at times, feel lost. We know what it can be like to kind of almost reach our breaking points and to fall down, and maybe fall down a lot. It happens to all of us. And it may be happening to some of us especially, in especially difficult ways right now. And so we offer that to you, God. We offer our brokenness, our pain, our struggle, knowing that you are with us. You never leave us alone in it. That you hold us and guide us through it, that we might continue to take one more step and rise again with you to meet the needs and the demands of this moment. God, whether we are feeling broken today or whether we feel enlivened and whole, you are here and you find us, and may our worship today honor that fact. May the way we live our lives and the way we sing our songs, the way we lean into to hearing a message or a prayer or a simple word, may it reflect the joy that we feel, that we are here now. We are alive here and today, and that is enough. That is enough. So God, surround us with your love. Guide our worship as we seek to follow you in word and deed, even as we pray these words of Jesus. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, would you please rise as you're able and find the blue hymnal, should be one right near you. In the blue hymnal number 566, Christ has called us to new visions.
Young and aging, men and women. thoughts and thinking, joined in one community. Christ beholding, feeling, needing, sins forgiven, life restored. Let us live God's justice being, strengthened by our risen Lord.
Please remain standing and find on the back of the worship bulletin the prayer for all of us. Your portion is in bold. Let us gather in this moment just as we are. Questioner, sinner, seeker, for we matter to God more than doctrine, liturgy, or creed. Let us gather in this space just as we are, less than perfect and fully human in our needs and longings. Let us gather wherever we find ourselves just as we are, each of us created in the poetry of love, and formed from the imagination of heaven. Let us interrupt the world this morning, wherever we are. And just as we are, let us worship God. Amen. You may be seated.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from Matthew chapter 5, verses 43 to 48, and I will be reading from the New Revised Standard Version. You have heard that it was said, "You shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy." But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and he sends rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. May God bless this reading and our understanding.
God, may the words of our scripture fill us and feed us. And may the words that I'm about to say find their way to a meaningful place in each heart and each life, that your Spirit may work and shine through them. In Christ we pray. Amen. So in my second year of seminary, I took a class called Prophets and the History of Ancient Israel with a wonderful professor named Marvin Chaney. He was someone who was beloved in the Graduate Theological Union in Berkeley. But he also had a reputation of being very hard. And one of my friends was the teacher's assistant in this class. And so I said, all right, so what's that mean by reputation? What kind of hard? And she said, well, I have a feeling it has to do with the amount of reading he assigns. And I said, oh, come on, how hard can that be? Well, I said that before I looked at the syllabus. With its double-digit number of full academic volumes, you know, the kind that have, like, minuscule writing on two columns per page, that kind. So more than 10 of those, plus the extensive list of photocopied articles that he'd give us in one giant bound volume. And it definitely gave me pause. But I decided to take the class because I had heard that he was retiring after that semester, and I heard he was wonderful, so I said, all right, I got to take advantage of this. Well, it didn't take long for the readings to pile up. I think it was, about day two.
Yeah.
I mean, it amounted to hundreds of pages each week, between 200 and 300 pages each week. And on top of having three other classes I was taking, plus I was an intern at Laguna Honda Hospital as a hospice chaplain, I found myself barely keeping my head above water, and I wasn't alone. Lots of my friends and fellow students were complaining about, feeling swamped so quickly. And so the TAs, they got together, and they decided they were going to offer us a chance to just help us out. And so they offered a workshop on how to handle a whole bunch of reading, basically how to learn some strategies on skim reading, okay? And we, about two-thirds of the class took that, and we left that feeling great, because I had never done anything like that. And that's what kind of got me. I started reading a book on rapid reading and all that kind of thing. But so we left that class feeling, much better about all those reading assignments. And so my TA friend came up afterwards and was saying, you know, it's funny, though. I went up and I told Professor Cheney that we did that. And he's like, oh, wonderful. So now, something along these lines, he said, everyone's going to feel better about keeping up with the assignments, right? And they said, yes, of course, we've given them some skills, and so they're going to feel much better. And this is what my TA was saying to him. She said, you know, part of the problem is that the students thought you expected them to read every single word. Yeah, Professor Cheney kind of gave her a look and said, well, I do expect them to read every single word. And that, right there, my friends, is what came to my mind when I read the scripture for this week. When I saw that line, Jesus' line to the crowds, that last one in particular, the be perfect one. As Jesus gives this big speech, the one we call the Sermon on the Mount, he is not setting the bar low. It's a pretty full syllabus he's giving them. He's telling the crowd that this is what they need to do. And this is paraphrasing from the larger Sermon on the Mount. He says, well, if someone strikes your right cheek, well, give them your left. Someone takes your coat, give them your cloak too. Someone asks you to go 1 mile, go that second mile. Someone wants anything from you, give it to them. Love your family, love your friends, but more than that, love your enemies and pray for them. And then Jesus delivers that bottom line, be perfect. Just be perfect. As your Father in heaven is perfect. Be perfect. When I think about being perfect, I think of things like that seminary class, about unrealistic expectations and harsh graders. And when I think about being perfect, even in a spiritual sense, I often picture God as a little bit of a divine professor. Kind of checking my work, a lot of red pen. Says, you know, it's quite evident to me that you have not done all the reading here, the assignment. I say that partly in jest, but I think a lot of us wrestle at various times in our lives with this image of God that's a lot like that. God is that ever-demanding, ever-critical authority figure, the parent you can never please. God is the teacher who's always disappointed. Or the client who always is complaining, no matter how hard you work. Maybe at its worst, we might experience God as our own critical inner voice, bent on reminding us how much we've just messed everything up. You know, and it'd be easy for me to stand here and say, you know, but hold on a second, that's not God, that's people, we do that. God is just love. And that's true. But then we have this passage where Jesus is standing there telling us to be perfect. And somewhere deep down, that feels unsettling. Because we all know, I don't measure up to perfect, and we never will. So what does this mean? And that's when it's important, I think, to remember that, you know what, God is a little bit different than that critical fifth grade teacher. Or that coach that used to berate us every time we'd miss a free throw. God isn't a divine taskmaster at best or a bully at worst. God is different than that. I think about my seminary professor and about how he expected a form of perfection, at least in our reading and our preparation for his class. And you know, when I think about it, seminary is no different than a lot of grad school, and that is, there's a component of hazing in it. And here's what I mean. I had a lot of professors that were all about, I had to do this, so here you go. It made me, the person I am today. Or they say, it doesn't kill you, it makes you stronger. That sort of idea comes through, certainly in seminary. But you know what? The journey of life and the life of faith is not about jumping through hoops like that. It's not about getting grades. It's not about looking good on paper. It's not even about reading every page. Instead, you know what it's about? It's about this. It's about progress. It's about moving forward. There's a great slogan that comes out of the recovery community, and it's in AA, and it goes, progress, not perfection. Progress, not perfection. And the idea is, we don't need to bother on focusing on trying to get every little detail right, because you know what happens when you try to do that. You get something wrong, then you berate yourself, you start to spiral maybe, and it comes very tempting to just give up, right? Just throw our hands up. But instead, this progress, not perfection idea, it's to help us focus on, do just a little better today, one day at a time, right? And I think that makes sense in the spiritual life too. Because no one, not on this side of heaven, is ever going to be perfect. But that doesn't mean we just get to throw up our hands and give up, right? We don't just give up. Instead, it means that a little at a time, we work on it. We try to get better. We become more generous, more patient, more compassionate, and more loving. And you know what? If we're doing it right, we also kind of start doing those kind of things for ourselves. Because in a world that's always demanding on us, always putting unrealistic demands on us, we could all stand to treat ourselves with a little bit more generosity and patience and compassion and love. No matter how we try, we can't beat ourselves into perfection. And there's nothing in tearing ourselves down or destroying ourselves that glorifies God. So I ask that we stop doing that. In recent months, as my youngest son has taken an interest in space in our solar system, I have likewise gotten really interested, and in particular, with all the goings-on around the James Webb Space Telescope that went into orbit, it was about a week before Christmas, I think it was. And you may have heard that it's the most powerful space telescope ever, and it's going to replace the Hubble, the famous Hubble Space Telescope with all those amazing pictures. This one's going to be 6 times better, and it's going to be 1 million miles from Earth and show us pictures of galaxies that we've never gotten to see. Now, you may know all that stuff. You may have heard that part. But I wonder if you know this. What you may not know is that the Webb Telescope has been in production since 1996. And originally it was supposed to be in orbit in 2007. 2007. 14 years ago. But all the trials and challenges and delays and problems and failures and all the stuff that got in the way made it so that it took another 14 years just to get where we are today. 24 years, all those starts and stops and ups and downs. And $9.7 billion later, that's more than the GDP of 50 different countries. But here's the thing that really blows me away. According to Mike Menzel, who's a lead mission systems engineer for the Webb program at NASA, even after all these years and all these plans and all these contingencies and all the money, there are still what he calls 344 points of failure, which is to say there are at least 344 ways that this whole thing could go wrong. If it's not perfect, something can go wrong. Now, not all of them will cause a total failure, but some of them could. So that's the risk. The entire success of the project could be threatened here. And when I mentioned this to my son, he asked, well, so what if it breaks? What happens? What do they do? What if it doesn't work? And I was reminded of when, back in 1986, when I was a high school student in New Hampshire, and because Krista McAuliffe was on the flight, she was a teacher from New Hampshire, we were all watching the Space Shuttle Challenger take off. And we all remember the horror of that, how difficult that was, watching that disaster unfold. But what I also remember is in the aftermath of that terrible event, there were scientists, there were people that got up to speak about the program in general. And they said things that stuck with me. They said things like, our space program has been forged for generations now through hopes and dreams and the successes and the failures of so many. Thousands of people have sacrificed blood, sweat, tears. And so even when things break, we dare not stop now.
Amen.
I said something like that to JJ, and he's like, what are they going to do if it breaks? I said, you know what? They're going to try again. They're going to try again. All of us mess up sometimes. Maybe today, maybe this morning. All of us mess up. But my guess is maybe you haven't been in charge of multi-millions of dollars of space equipment that could go wrong and become space junk in a blink of an eye. But here's the funny thing, is that even if you were in charge of all that stuff, NASA would forgive you. And they'd try again. Why? Because that's what you do. You keep trying. You keep learning from your mistakes and building on what you've learned, and you dare to try again. If NASA can forgive a broken rocket or a satellite or even maybe a space telescope, perhaps God can forgive our brokenness too. And perhaps we can head back to the drawing board. We can figure out what went wrong and we can try again. Well, here's the good news. A space flight might require sort of perfection, but life doesn't, friends. We get to make mistakes all the time, every day, and we still get to live. We all get it wrong sometimes, but we also all get to know that we're forgiven. The only thing that we can't do is stop trying. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Oh,
you all. I want to invite the congregation to find the closing song. It's in the Hallelujah Songbook. I don't have my bulletin with me. What's the number? It's Amazing Grace. 54. Number 54. Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. Please rise as you're able. Times that you fall down, that you feel lost or broken, may they be met with that hand that invites you to rise. It might be the hand of a friend, a family member, or a stranger, but know this, it is always the hand of God. May you receive and may you become connected to that hand, that the world may know of God's grace and love. Go in the peace and the spirit of that love until we meet again. Amen.
Amen.
But don't leave.